news. I mean,
there's a big story in yesterday's Newsday in which Rob suggests. Now, here's the problem with having a cast, as we do on the Irish Morning Program, of about all together around 10 people. Rob describes himself as the most prolific and funniest cast member of the Imus the Morning Show, as well as the most successful comic ever to come out of Farmingdale High School. Jerry Seinfeld went to neighboring Massapequa High, by the way. Or maybe that's William Falk, the guy who wrote this article. Maybe he's describing Rob as that.
Yeah, but where did he get the idea?
Well, he got the idea from Rob. This is the single biggest suck-up piece. It's an embarrassing piece, and I'm firing Rob this morning.
Does the guy listen?
It bothered me.
I'm having Rob. When Rob comes in this morning, just tell him he's fired. In fact, you tell him, okay, Bernard?
10-4.
Okay. Rob will be happy to.
Don't let him come back to the office either. Meet him at the door.
And he's got to, exactly. Don't even meet him up in the studio cafe because he always stops by there to see what they're serving for lunch.
Yeah. Right. Have a security guard escort him down to get his stuff out.
Exactly. Have a security guard escort him down to get his stuff in his files and get it out. No, let's confiscate the stuff in his files.
That's it. I was going to say,
why are you going to let him in the building?
No, we're not even going to let him in the building.
Well, now that he's gone, who'll be the most prolific and funniest person on the show? That would be Larry Kenney.
That would be Larry Kenney, yeah.
Yeah, fine.
Hey, man.
So anyway.
jealousy.
Well, Rob has something to fall back on. He'll be headlining at the Sands Hotel in Las Vegas starting tomorrow.
Yeah.
Hopefully that will turn into a... maybe he can go over and work with Scott and Todd.
He'll spend more time with his family like he says he wants to do.
Sure. Exactly. He has his three kids. Maybe he can spend time with them.
That's right.
As he claims he wants to do.
And didn't spend any time talking about us in that article.
No, he didn't.
Yeah.
So. More free time to sit down and watch the Comedy Channel and take notes.
Hey, man.
Howard.
It's 23 after the hour here in the Imus the Morning Program.
What's up with the crickets, Imus?
You washed up.
NFL.
Don't be in a phone booth.
NFL teams have made all their selections now.
And
the New York Jets selected a real dandy, flashy wide receiver, Keyshawn Johnson. The talented Johnson said it was important that he was picked by a team that resides in a city.
I'm from a big city in Los Angeles, whether it's Chicago, just a city in general, I think is a good fit for me.
Keyshawn obviously unaware all NFL teams now play in cities. But the Jets, of course, ecstatic. Here's Coach Rich Kotite on Keyshawn's size.
As a big man, he can do all the things a little man can do.
Why don't you pick a little man then?
Well, not to feed him as much.
Get two little men.
Exactly.
Come on.
What a moron. Why pick a big man? Because he can do all the things a little guy can do.
Well, who wrote that for you, Mike? Rob?
Well, here now, the funniest, most prolific member of the Imus the Morning Program.
Stop, let me grab my sides. Go ahead, boss.
Grab my sides going in,
okay,
so I'm ready.
I'm ready.
Rob Bartlett, good morning, Rob.
Hey, man.
Yeah, how you doing, Howard? Hey, Bernard, there's some good news, babe.
What is it?
Rogaine's over the counter now.
That's the kind of stuff you get. You don't get that anywhere else, baby.
Can't you just keep it right where it is? How about this, Milwaukee?
Oh, God.
So this is a disgraceful piece.
Why is it disgraceful?
Well, because... you did suck up to me a lot, but...
Well, wasn't that the agenda?
I guess, yeah. Man, you all excited about Vegas?
Very excited. Very pumped.
Do you have the New York Times there?
Yeah, I do.
Okay, D9.
Yeah.
A big article on the I-Man.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, but of course, that's D9. That's way back in the paper, isn't it?
It's in the business.
All the way to the back of the paper.
Yeah, it's in the business section of the New York Times, the most widely circulated paper in America, unlike Newsday, which you can't give away.
Well, it's the My Weekly Reader of Long Island,
yeah. Okay, well.
Oh, God.
Weekly Reader!
So, Rob.
Yeah?
Here's your assignment today.
Go ahead.
You buy a copy of the New York Times.
Yeah.
You turn to page D9.
Yeah.
You memorize this article.
Okay. Okay.
And there'll be a test when you get to work today.
Okay.
Get off the phone.
I just want to ask a question.
Yeah.
What shoe store is Bernie doing tomorrow?
Oh.
Oh, I get it.
Oh. Which shoe store is Bernie doing?
Ouch.
Oh, really?
Actually, it's a tire store on Saturday.
Hey, New York, call waiting. The Imus channel is now open.
Hi, it's Imus standing by to share my secret life with you.
That's right. Now, you can reach out and touch a figure of legend, Radio Hall of Famer Don Imus. Have you made contact yet? What are you waiting for? Don Imus is ready to pick up the Imus in the Morning phone line hotline. 4.5 hours, 5 days a week on the radio won't satisfy the inner Imus fan. So now, he's making himself available in person and in private to satiate those cravings for...
More Imus!
Sure, radio's great, but now talk to the man one-on-one.
Hey, it's Imus. Are you little peaches fuzzy, huh? I didn't tell me Imus wants to know, baby. Oh, I see. What it is, it's slippery. Is your big old sweet potato slippery, baby? Tell me about the big old tuba you got.
How intimate can you get? Or need a good laugh at your next party? Call Imus. Put him on the speakerphone. Tell him to say regularly or Nachman and break out the beer.
Regularly.
Ha, ha, ha. What a drooling fool. And it's all available on the Imus in the Morning phone line hotline. But wait, what about sex, you say? Imus has no sex life, but he can dream, can't he?
Have you ever wondered what Dean Rusk would look like wailing on Olympia Dukakis, turtle style, in an igloo? I have, and I'll tell you. Give me a call.
It's hot. It's steaming. It's your open channel to Imus. 24 hours a day. To the man who never sleeps at 1-900-BOREDOM. 1-900-BOREDOM. He's made his friend's eyes glaze over. Now it's your turn. Call now. Kids, get mom and dad's permission before dialing or poison their food. Either way, you're a winner. $50 first minute, $25 each minute thereafter. The Imus phone line hotline is a service of Salmonex Deep Sleep Aids. Busy signal, Imus is also available at 1-900-COMA. Call now.
Say to that, whatever happened to all those great Jewish blues singers from the 60s, huh? Remember Room Full of Jews? The Jews Project? The Jews Magoos? The Moody Jews? Little Shlomo and the Rabbis of Seoul?
I woke up yesterday. I didn't know what to do. I lost my yarmulke. Now I can't go to shul.
What makes Bigelow herbal teas the perfect way to unwind almost any time?
Jesus, God.
Jeez.
God, oh, out of the blue. Boom, just out of nowhere.
When are these Marcus Allen trial going to start, man?
Yeah, I'll get your response on the program.
You know. Some will talk about, you know, Bob Dole and Bill Clinton.
Yeah, just on and on.
Well, they'll, that's just pointless, isn't it?
Yeah, I know.
It's, and it's all been ruined.
There's no drama left. It's all of that.
Pat Buchanan couldn't have tempered his remarks enough to get a few more votes.
Mm-hmm.
Legitimate,
absolutely.
But now the little jug-eared Martian, Ross Perot, is such a joke that that's pointless.
Oh, get away.
I mean, just... So the whole thing is just not shaping up to be any fun at all. And have we already agreed to go out for the Republican convention in San Diego?
That appears to be the case,
I'd like to go to COGO anyway, because it's a powerful affiliate
there. Well, then it's a good time to go, on that basis alone, and, you know.
It's only about 100 degrees in San Diego in August.
There's air conditioning on
there. You already look like you're melting. That's
the difference. You know, Jesus. I just can't hate him any more than I do.
Right now, just down the road from Ted and Jane's place, somewhere in the great state of Montana, Rush Limbaugh.
Endless tracts of pristine, unspoiled wilderness, vast expanses of infinite azure sky. Ah, behold the stunning spectacle. You know, I'm not big on the conservation of natural resources, endangered species, or any of those other eco-Nazi environmental issues. If a spotted owl loses its life when a tree is cut down, better him than me. That's pure Darwin at work. But I must admit that after experiencing the natural beauty and wonder known as Montana, I am duly humbled and impressed. Your friends at the Montana Board of Tourism want you to know that their state isn't just a refuge for paramilitary malcontents or homicidal hermits. It's a vacation wonderland. America the way it ought to be. Wide open spaces, both on the ground and in between the ears of some of its more than 870,000 member population. It's big sky country. Over 147,000 square miles of purple mountain majesties and fruited plains. So when you consider that the odd bad bomber and militia loon only inhabit a mere 10 by 12 shack or cabin trailer, there's plenty of room left for you.
Well,
and room there is. About half the state is grassland.
Mm-hmm.
Not very good cover, mind you, but in the event of a violent overthrow of the existing government, there are more than 22 million acres of forest land, which means there are plenty of trees to hide behind. The economy is dominated by agriculture, with livestock representing about half the state income. So if you too decide to drop out of society and live like a mountain man, not only is there food in abundance, but during those long periods of soundless solitude, you're physical needs can be attended to as well. With a peak elevation of 12,799 feet, it's plain to see why so many free men experience a Rocky Mountain high. It's a place that can be the muse that inspires a writer to come up with 35,000 words of prose. Somewhere one can escape to and feel hidden. I bet that's one of the main reasons Montana is known as the Treasure State. The Western Meadowlark, the Ponderosa Pine, the Custer Battlefield, all this and the fact that the state has consistently voted Republican in presidential elections since 1968. So don't buy into all the bad press they've received of late. Visit the paradise where the occasional reactionary recluse only helps to keep the wild in wildlife. Come to Montana, where a man can really make a stand. Or, for that matter, a stand-off.
This land's not your land, this land is my land, 'cause you weren't born a true blue American. I'm an ethnic purist who protects his borders. This land belongs to only me.
This land is my land, it isn't your land. It's not Jamaica, Haiti, or Pakistan. I suggest you all go home to your motherland. 'Cause this land belongs to only me. As I was walking down by unemployment, heard towelheads talking of overthrowing our government. I'm declaring open season on all illegal immigrants. 'Cause this land's overrun by refugees.
This land's not your land, this land is my land. 'Cause you weren't born a true blue American. I'm an ethnic purist who protects his borders. This land belongs to only me.
Between all the faggots that are being outed, feminazis and wetbacks, it's getting crowded. Too many Negroes on welfare. Bubba doesn't think about it. But this land's being hosed by Hillary. As I went walking, I saw signs in Spanish. Why can't they learn English? I wish they'd vanish. They can take the Jews with them and a few thousand Amish. Till this land is free of minorities.
This land's not your land, this land is my land. 'Cause you weren't born a true blue American. I'm an ethnic purist who protects his borders. This land belongs to only me.
There's been an invasion
of the non-Caucasian, boatloads of Asian, and the black persuasion, prevent the white man's erasion, and save our nation. This land can thrive on bigotry.
This land's not your land, this land is my land, 'cause you weren't born a true blue American. I'm an ethnic purist who protects his borders. This land belongs to only me.
Former Senator Barry Goldwater, San Francisco, 1964.
Now, I don't seek the presidency to strip this nation of its defenses or to abandon the cause of freedom around the world. I seek the presidency so that this nation will be strong enough to deter war and determined enough to encourage freedom. I ask your help and the help of all Americans, so that an American president can tell Nikita Khrushchev, you are wrong. Our children will not live under communism. Your children will live under freedom.
And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA.
I miss in the morning.
Now picture this, your guests have arrived, you're pouring the water.
Now for the New York Lotto numbers, and here over from the Archdiocese, John Cardinal O'Connor. Good morning, Cardinal O'Connor.
Good morning, God bless.
Well, fine.
The winning numbers in the New York State Lottery is as follows.
I like it when you start right in and just move right through.
The daily number.
All right.
Beautiful.
389.
389.
When we write it down.
Got it.
Well, first it was Amy Fisher, Amos Namard.
Pardon me?
First it was Amy Fisher.
Soon
it'll be Sol Wattler.
Right.
But for now, did you hear?
No.
Playwright Neil Simon bought the rights to the Ankle Rosenbaum story.
Oh, no. Well, all right.
He'd call it Fiddler on the Roof meets Five Guys Named Moby Jesus. The take-down numbers is as follows. McCord, you see Malcolm X yet?
No, I haven't had enough.
When hell freezes over, right, Chuck? Yes. Jesus, you blue-eyed devil, you. McCord will be out coon hunting this week anyway, Jesus, you know what I mean? The win four number. 3723.
Let me just stop a second here. Let's just stop a second.
Thank you, I-Man.
We have these meetings in the office, and I think I cover everything. I was talking to somebody about this last night. I said, I cover everything that I can possibly think of with him. I said, we're not going to stick anything in something. We're not going to have fluids coming out of anything.
Body orifices,
we're not going to call anybody lesbians or queers. Or we're not going to... And you can't cover it all.
Shut up, you droopy skin scope.
Please continue, Cardinal O'Connor.
Well, you'll be spending Thanksgiving, Amos Navarre.
I'll be in Southport.
Well, I tell you what, if you get up near the cathedral... Stay the hell away, I'll have you arrested, Jesus. I do have a little limerick, I miss them all. A little limerick prayer. Giving thanks with the eye, man.
Okay.
Gather on the radio, boys and girls. Yeah. We'll call this Thanksgiving in South Park. Fine. Or Home Alone Again.
There we go.
Shut up. Three mil a year, a limo, a rolls. What more could he want? Except a face without holes. Turkey and stuffing, loved ones in the house. And none of that there. They all hate this louse. But the I-Man don't care. On pasta he'll be picking. And after the football game, he'll just choke his chicken. So Eileen, Breen and Chuck, Lou with the red hair, repeat after me. Join me in prayer. O Lord, we give much thanks on this Thanksgiving.
O Lord, we give much thanks on this Thanksgiving.
Except for the fact that the I-Man is living. On ahead.
Except for the fact that the I-Man is living.
So if some paid lover should visit this loner.
So if some paid lover should visit this loner.
Let's hope the I-Man suffocates on his boner. Amen. God bless us and save us. Have a lovely Thanksgiving, the whole lot of you.
The pick 10 numbers is as follows.
Oh, we don't want the pick 10 numbers. All right, well, go ahead. What are they?
The pick 10 numbers is as follows. 4, 11, 12, 13, 17, 18, 22, 25, 31, 35, 36, 38, 41, 43, 53, 59, 62, 63, 68, 80.
Fine. 80. Thank you very much, Cardinal O'Connor.
All right.
Which doesn't belong in why?
Which doesn't belong in why?
Which doesn't belong in why?
A. Batman.
Batman.
B. Superman.
Superman.
C. The I-Man.
Which doesn't belong in why?
Well, I would think the I-Man.
Wrong, you two-legged colts, are you? Well, all three peaked in the 60s. And still thought they looked good in tights in the 90s. The answer is A. Batman doesn't belong because unlike the other two, the bulge in Batman's tights was natural, be Jesus. Run ahead.
Where belong you, schmucky?
1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3.
If you're looking for the technology of a serious camera but the spontaneity of point and shoot, now you doesn't have to choose between the two.
CBS Radio, all rights reserved. Imus in the Morning is a presentation of WFAN and Westwood One Entertainment. I'm Westwood.
This concludes the entertainment and revenue-generating portion of your broadcast day. We now return you to the rest of your local programming schedule, an indecipherable embarrassment of broadcasting incompetence that compelled the station to subscribe to the Imus in the Morning program in the first place. The entertainment and revenue-generating portion of the broadcast day, the Imus in the Morning program, will resume tomorrow morning. Check your local listings for time and schedule.
WFAN New York. WFAN 2020 Sports.
Good morning. It's 10 o'clock. I'm Don LaGreca.
You just flat out said I'm
Diana, the flagship station of New York Jets football.
It is 10:05 on the fan. Good morning and a happy Thanksgiving to you. Kurt Menefee here with you until 12:15 this afternoon. 718-937-6666 is the number. As we like to say, light up my life by lighting up those phones here on this Thanksgiving Day. Kind of a dreary, cold, not pretty day outside, but certainly a day where Yankee fans at least have a lot to be thankful for. Well, the Yankees...
I'm Mr. Washington's senior political analyst, the late Richard M. Nixon.
Fine, fine, Jesus. What a nightmare.
What's wrong?
Thanksgiving. God almighty. David and Julie, Trisha and that cock sucker, that whole Gay and Wilson cartoon refugee camp of a family of mine.
Uh-huh.
How'd you like to have to get together with that outfit year after year? Imus in the Morning. I never forget. Say, where'd you go? To Fred's?
Mm-hmm.
Well, then you had your own cross to bear. Let me return thanks, if I may. I am thankful that Thanksgiving, thankfully, is over. Jesus. So, what else happened over the weekend? Did Bobby McCoy throw another litter or anything? I haven't had the opportunity to speak with you since the McCoys rolled a 7, so if I may turn my focus there for a moment or so.
Okay.
And I'd like to address the McCoys, Bobby Kenny, directly.
Mm-hmm.
Bob Kenster, can you say exploitation? You have just been given the neonatal equivalent of a winning Powerball ticket. Use it. Sign everything. Nike diapers, Gatorade from a nipple, Topps septuplet cards, sky's the limit. And Time Magazine was right last week. The McCoy's pre-existing child, little Michaela, is it? A loser. A drag on the rest of the family. I'm sure they're well aware of that fact themselves, J.D., and they're probably thinking, you know, too bad Louise Woodward is restricted to the state of Massachusetts, don't you suppose?
No.
Oh, by the way, I'm probably going to take some heat on this one, but I'm sorry. I don't care what anybody says. Premature babies look to be exactly what they are. Half-baked. Bulletin. The video of them on Dateline was not cute.
No.
They looked like they could have been the spawn of the bug monster and alien, for crying out loud. It's just that nobody will admit it.
Okay.
Well, they'll be fine, of course, but keep the cameras off of them until they are. Oh, and Bobby, you've been given a van, a new house, all sorts of other stuff. How about fixing your f***ing teeth? I mean, we're going to have to see these people for the rest of our lives, J.D. Oh, say, I heard your chat with Senator Bob Kerry a few days back. Very impressive fellow. You don't suppose, though, do you, that he and this squeeze he's got there in New York would go the fertility drug route, should he ever gain the White House? Haven't we had our fill pretty much of White House offspring? I mean, think Amy Carter. And I believe you'll grasp my point.
Yeah.
Septuplet carries, each with its own Secret Service detail? I don't think so. Final thoughts, Dono. Iraq, guiding our policy, Bill Cohen, Bill Richardson, Bill Clinton. Forget cemetery plots. What the Democrats should be selling is f***ing fallout shelters. Jesus, what a mess. And regarding Saddam Hussein, assassinate him? Hey, there hasn't been anybody able to hide stuff like that since Maggie Williams. Kill him? If I'm Bill Clinton, I'm putting him on a retainer. Ouch! And there's your post-Thanksgiving peek into the dick scope, my dude, from a once equally distressed president of the United States.
I want to grow up to be just like me, never have to work. Just travel around from town to town, wherever evil lurks. Across the Holy Land with rod in hand and sandals on my feet. But I'll stop a while and I'll share a smile with everyone I meet.
I'm a sin in the morning.
You wonder why your throat is...
Classic rock station Q104 exposing the ugly underbelly of life in California. I'll tell you that. And exposing all the different troubles on the roadways.
Oh, yeah.
Well, good morning. Mike Breen with sports. Bill Zimfer the call. WQAM in Miami, where the Dolphins stayed in first with a 30-10 victory over the New Orleans Saints. Dan Marino throws his 400th career touchdown
really,
pass.
I mean, it's time to retire. It's just time to say, well, I'll just go down to Arkansas, the lake, and I'll fish. I'll do something else.
That's a good idea.
Go ahead.
Are you sure?
Yes. I guess.
Yes.
Well, I'm not happy with your sports reports this morning either, by the way.
But go ahead. I prefer not to make eye contact.
Well, I don't.
Good idea.
We started at 6:08. Our new employee, Kara, you called a nitwit at 6:08.
No, no, I didn't call Kara a nitwit. I said that Michelle is a nitwit. And do we need a nitwit training Kara? Because Michelle has done a pretty good job up until the time she announced she was leaving, and then we went out of our way to get her a job. She's moving out to L.A. with her hideous boyfriend, and who's going to some interior decorating school in Texas someplace. Mm-hmm. And so what did we do? We go on the air, and we get her a job at Access Hollywood. It's not no small. We had to threaten Pat O'Brien, didn't we?
Certainly we did.
Yep.
Yep. Harass him every day.
That's exactly what we had to do.
Stay on his back.
We can't hear you. Get closer to the microphone. Pretend like you're talking on the air.
Let's think about this.
No.
May I make a suggestion?
Yeah.
Perhaps something has changed over the four-day weekend. Because
can
I'm
you
doing
hear?
Nothing different.
Do you have your effing headphones in your ear? Can you hear what's going on?
I certainly can.
Where was I now?
Michelle's last day is December 11th.
Pressuring O'Brien.
So we get Michelle a job at Access Hollywood, and by threatening O'Brien.
Right.
And immediately, her performance on this program goes to hell in a handbasket.
Oh, certainly. Right. She doesn't need it in her mind.
I have January 7th in the pool, by the way.
What's that?
First Cara tears. The only reason it's not closer is because of the two
Michelle, have I ever made you cry on a program?
No.
No, I've been around. No, I don't make people cry. I've been very
not
nice
anymore.
To her.
Not anymore. Nor Dana either.
You know who I think suggested that we feature Boomer Esiason on the program?
Who?
Michelle. I think that was her one contribution.
Oh, there you go. And a good one.
A great one. Here now, live from San Francisco. Are you in San Francisco?
Yeah, I'm in San Francisco.
Man, how much do you hate this?
I hate it. I can't tell you how much I hate it, because it's like 5:45 out here right now.
We know
that. I just have to listen to you whining on radio, picking on Michelle. And if Michelle wants a job, she can come work for Monday Night Football, the big show.
Boomer Esiason's appearance, begrudging appearance, is sponsored by Cadillac, and we were talking earlier this morning how we've really developed a real loathing for you, and you for us, by the way.
Oh, yeah.
And
beautiful.
we used to love Boomer.
Certainly.
Yeah, I don't know what's happened. This whole thing has just deteriorated as we've gone on here.
And the thing that we were most happy about is knowing the program Boomer is sponsored by Cadillac Motor Car Division and your local Cadillac dealers. It's 7 minutes on till the end.
I ain't looking to block you up, shock or knock or lock you up. I ain't looking for you to feel like me, see like me, or be like me. All I really wanna do is baby be friends with you.
I'm a sin in the morning.
KRLA. Which we debut on this morning, they've just got to be thinking. Well, you know, this is a great radio program. It actually is. That doesn't have a lot to do with me, but... And this morning's not a great example of it, but it's okay. So, but it's we're not going to be number one in Los Angeles, so I don't think anybody out there has to worry about Rick Dees or Mark and Brian or whoever it is.
No.
I don't think they are worried, nor should they.
Running for cover, I don't think so, no.
But we will make a lot of money for the radio station, which is... We are so far from being number one in New York, it's not even funny. Except that, so it's not that we don't have an enormous number of listeners. It's just that other people have more, but they don't have any money.
They live in their cars.
That's exactly the Howard Stern listeners who actually, you know, go to wrestling matches and live in their cars. But WFAN in New York, which is our home station, is the number one billing radio station in America. Certainly, cool, obviously, that would include New York, by over $10 million. So if you're even a remotely competent salesperson, let's say KRLA, you can go out and sell the program and be successful at doing that.
Sure, no problem.
Because we can sell the stuff. Well, we can't sell junk. It's the only problem. I mean, I wouldn't go pitch a bunch of
penis enlargers.
No. Penis, you know, or you know stuff, you know.
We're talking about Coke and...
You know, hair products or used car dealers and stuff like that. But if it's the legitimate quality products, we can... So we'll do very well. People will make a lot of money at KRLA. And I'm very happy to be on a radio station because I grew up listening to it. Back when Dave Hall and Gene Weed and Bob Eubanks and Emperor Bob Hudson and Ted Quillen and... Well, there are a lot of different guys there. So.
Sure.
They're doing a survey of...
Those guys must be dead.
Some of them are, I guess, yes. I guess Bob Eubanks is not dead. He's a game show guy.
He's still doing it.
He used to be a pretty good disc jockey. Hmm. But KRLA, this was before... The big rival in those days was KFWB. When KFWB was a rock and roll radio station. With B. Mitchell Reed and... Man, does it get any more tedious than this?
No, I don't know.
You know, you're thinking, God, is he going to shut up about... Who the F cares about Gene Weed? Shut up. Either say something funny or just shut up.
The iCast with a hullabaloo. 2 minutes past 4 o'clock, 4:02 KRLA request time. Way out in Tarzana, way in at 989-2500.
KRLA request
are...
edition of the news sponsored by A&E.
Democratic National Committee, the senior senator from the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, Senator Edward Moore Kennedy.
Yes, yes, that's right. It's in New Jersey. Place called the Afternoon Delight Escort Service. All over the papers. We've got to find out if my name is still on the client list.
No, no.
You want me to end up like Clinton, for God's sake?
Senator, what are you doing?
Excuse me?
We're in the air here.
Oh, indeed. Yes, just, I'm just, well, just checking to see if my name appears on the roster of a whorehouse, actually. Be that as it may, the Democratic National Committee and I have purchased this time today to address a matter of grave urgency. President Clinton is soon to enter his testimony, as you know, before the Monica Lewinsky grand jury by way of closed-circuit television. The stakes are high. Mr. Clinton's staff has been hard at work deciding how best to position the president for this critical moment. No detail is being overlooked. Not only is testimony being discussed in great depth, but so are elements of the setting in which Mr. Clinton will appear. Posture, hand position, facial expression, background, clothing. All of these variables can be of tremendous importance to overall credibility. Now, there has been speculation Mr. Clinton might assert his Fifth Amendment right against self-incrimination, or his Fourth Amendment right to privacy, to avoid answering certain lines of inquiry about his relationship with Ms. Lewinsky. Should he? I think not. I don't believe America will accept such a stance, particularly if, as expected, laboratory tests reveal the love dress is soiled with presidential ejaculate matter.
Fine.
Therefore, the leadership of the Democratic Party and I urgently ask the president to consider the following suggestions for his grand jury appearance to best explain away these scurrilous charges. One, that he adhere to his previous statement, I did not have sex with that woman. Two, that he make the statement with the same vigor demonstrated when he initially made the assertion. And three, that as he repeats those words, he slowly, dramatically rise from behind the desk or table where he will be seated to reveal to his grand jury audience that from the waist down, below his suit jacket and tie, he is wearing a garter belt, crotchless panties, and fishnet hose, what is known as the IMUS defense. For while startling to reveal that in private, Mr. Clinton obtains orgiastic satisfaction from wearing women's clothing, it is our feeling that America will be far more tolerant of a fetish than it would be of using the power of the presidency to persuade an impressionable, slightly daft 21-year-old that it's a good idea to let the leader of the free world stick his pecker in her mouth. Therefore, let the word go forth from this time and place. Ask not what Mr. Clinton should say before the Star Grand Jury.
Yeah.
Ask, rather, what Mr. Clinton should wear before the Star Grand Jury.
Oh, sure.
Mr. President, you approach a true watershed moment.
Oh, no.
To her credit, America is a society of forgiveness.
Senator.
A little Victoria's Secret number will be viewed as nothing more than a...
President. Approaches what sort of moment, Senator?
A real watershed, Imus. Mm-hmm. Most important moment of his entire career.
That's what I thought you said.
Oh. You know, you're such a sucker. Are you sure you shouldn't be subpoenaed, you bastard?
Bring it. Yeah. A little sick with it, baby.
Getting jiggy with it.
Getting, well, getting jiggy with it. Raise the roof, y'all.
Way back when I was governor of Arkansas, had a little love nest of the Excelsior. State troopers would bring the fresh meat to me, just like they want some pizza delivery. There was one who really turned up my thermostat, thought I'd treat her like groceries in Baghdad. She was margarine and thought she was a higher price bread. Didn't bag her, though she could have used a bag for her head. But for a while I got down with Miss America, and I defiled her crown because I was boning her. With a swimsuit, heels, and libido, she won the talent competition in my limo. And the nightclub singer with the fine-looking tush used to plant my seed in that flower's bush. I actually made to think that we'd walk down the aisle, just one of the little tricks of the slick Willie style. Maybe cause I'm president, all my wiener's just a little bit bent. But you can call me Tricky Dick, the way I have to beat the babes off with a stick. Chuck up another notch as I put another lady's hand on my crotch and cover up the whole thing with denial. That's what I call slick Willie style. Hot tamale named Dolly taught the golden rule, getting jolly on her back way back in high school. Used to like to study her biology. She got high marks and everything but chastity. Went cruising with Susan when she was still cute. Now she choosing to cruise in an orange jumpsuit. A Jones for my jammy and what I deliver. But before she give me up, she'd rather go up the river. The slick Willie style make the ladies all swoon. I just don't know why Hillary is immune. Cause even a widow will forget me not. Hobby wasn't called for. I got the girl hot in the Oval Office for a minute. Day grope, grabbed her on the butt, tried to help the girl cope, made her forget her troubles for a while, working up a sweat with my slick Willie style. Maybe cause I'm president, all my wiener's just a little bit bent, but you can call me Tricky Dick, the way I have to beat the babes off with a stick. Chuck up another notch as I put another lady's hand on my crotch. Cover up the whole thing with denial. That's what I call slick Willie style. Intern's first day when she walked through the door, didn't remember ever coming across her face before. I had no Viagra aphrodisiac, but I was packing more wood than a lumberjack. Asked what it would take for her to go with me, and she said she loved music and poetry. So I read her a Shakespeare sonnet while she took out my saxophone and put her lips on it. She was just a little older than a juvenile, but turned the girl into a woman with my slick Willie style. Maybe cause I'm president, all my weed is just a little bit bent. But you can call me Tricky Dick, the way I have to beat the babes off with a stick. Chuck up another notch as I put another lady's hand on my crotch. Cover up the whole thing with denial. That's what I call slick Willie style.
Getting Jay Willie now, my boss. 28 minutes after the hour here on the IMUS of the Morning program, the executive jet Boeing and General Electric introducing the new Boeing business jet. And you can see it out of Teterboro Airport.
We can. Yeah, it's there now. Right?
And
who I had a very unpleasant conversation with last evening.
Really?
I'll tell you what I figured out.
Yeah.
I don't need that Viagra. All I got to do is look at a big old picture of a John Deere backhoe. He gives me a boner he can drive a railroad spike in with.
If your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to IMUS in the morning.
Anyway, here from Paris is Bud Collins. Good morning, Mr. Collins.
Bonjour, Monsieur IMUS. How are you?
Oh, God, please. I'm fine. Where are you?
I'll give you information. We're on the air tomorrow at 3 o'clock and Sunday at 1:30 with the French Open.
How's Venus Williams doing?
Well, she's just gone onto the court. I'm glad you asked.
Why would you do that? To make the fool out of this lovely man say, how's Venus Williams doing?
Yes,
and you knew it would go right. I mean, he's in France. He knew it'd go right over.
How's Venus Williams? Well,
that's funny.
The expectant father.
I'm in the morning.
how that music used to make me smile. And I knew if I had my chance that I could make those people dance, and maybe they'd be happy for a while. But February made me shiver with every paper I deliver. Bad news on the doorstep, I couldn't take one more step. I can't remember if I cried when I read about his widowed bride, but something touched me deep inside the day the music died.
Right here in front of me. It is. I do. All right, check this out. You're 12 yards.
At the 26-yard line, 6 seconds to play. The game on the line right here. Three wide receivers to the left. Bledsoe in the shotgun. Way in. And it is incomplete. A flag in the end zone. A flag in the end zone as time ran out.
An incredible finish in Foxborough. Good morning. Mike Breenwood Sports. Van Miller the call. WGRF in Buffalo. Patriots beat the Bills 25-21. That pass interference call on the final play put the ball on the one. Game can't end on a defensive penalty. Patriots then scored the winning touchdown on the next play. The Bills so incensed about the call, they would not take the field for the extra point. Patriots out there all by themselves, and the kicker ran it in for a two-point conversion, which was huge. When you talk about the point spread, if the Bills got 3 points, a lot of people are very unhappy. You took Buffalo. Bills Gabe Northern was also steamed.
Been playing ball since I was eight years old. I'm 24 right now. Never in my whole life have I ever seen anything like that. A pass interference on a Hail Mary.
Very upset, the Buffalo Bills.
A whole 22 years.
Many felt it was a bad call. I say wrong. Good call by the official. Let's salute him this morning for standing up and making a gutsy call in the final seconds.
Oh, well, I mean, it's so outrageous.
Clearly interference.
Here's... It's clearly not interference.
Oh, that's baloney.
And you are such a moron. When you've got last play of the game and it's jump ball in the end zone, nobody ever calls that.
Let's change the rules because it's the last play.
No. But nobody calls that anyway. Yeah. I've never seen that called
because...
at the first play of the game. First play of the game.
You know why no one calls that?
No, I don't.
Because what Henry Jones did, you never see done. They at least go up and try and hit the ball themselves. Jones clearly just shoved the receiver. Did not make any attempt.
You know, you are such you are wrong on this.
You're
one, I'm
Paul Tagliabue butt munch.
You're unbelievable.
Just because I find him attractive.
I mean, it's disgraceful. But go ahead.
Here's Patriots linebacker Teddy Johnson.
I've never seen anything like that. That's why I'm really kind of overwhelmed. You know, I'm just sitting here. Did that just happen? You know, I'm saying there's no way that just happened, but it did.
I guess so. Patriots and Bills now both 7-5.
So that's the guy from the team that won, right?
Yeah. They're about a game back of the Jets, who are 8-4.
And you're going on about what a great call it was, and a guy from the team that won that thought it was a goofy call.
No, he didn't say
maybe he had money on Buffalo.
Well,
48-21, Jets beat Carolina.
Now, will the Buffalo Bills team be fined, or will there be some action?
My guess is yes.
For their refusal to come out for the... They refused to line up for the extra point attempt.
Right. And then Pete Carroll rubbed it in by telling a kicker to run it in.
And the point spread was 3 points. And the Patriots won by... Buffalo was an underdog by 3 points, and the Patriots won by 4.
They'll get fined depending on if Tagliabue took the Bills of the Patriots in his weekly sheet.
Right. Which means, you know...
Yeah, the 2 points.
To all of the people... announcers like Al Michaels and Mike Breen who bet on these games.
Warner Wolf
and try to affect the outcome and their enthusiasm and so on, or lack of it for these various teams. Huh?
You lost.
Yeah.
Jets win 48-21. Great performance against Carolina, but of course Bill Parcells throwing some cold water on his players.
It's just one game out of 16 games. That's all it is. You know, it's nothing monumental. We won the game and we're able to keep playing, but You know, every week doesn't have to be a glossary on the team.
The Parcells press conference, the highlight of the New York Jets radio network post-game show, with our man reporter Dave Jennings, who anchors the Parcells press conference.
Now, Bill Parcells is up on the podium. It's going to be a few seconds, though, before he's able to start, because there are a lot of people outside filing in.
So fast.
So we'll just have to wait and wait for these folks to bear in. But it's two nice wins in a row, 8-4. Stolen first place, 4 to go.
There's a lot of people outside.
Yep, just hear Frank Ramos, a lot of people outside. Chiefs beat the Cardinals, 31-24. We just have a final score. A lot of people outside. Takes a while for them to file in here. This room is just off the locker room. And Bill's standing up on the podium waiting for us.
Pick up the milk and wait home.
A lot of people outside.
A lot of them.
We just have to bear with us.
Just hang in there.
Guys, there's room up front.
A lot of people outside.
A lot of people.
There's not much more I can tell you, folks, so just bear with us.
How's your Thanksgiving?
A lot of people outside.
Well.
Okay, go ahead. I have to be happy with the way we played overall.
And there it is. That's where he starts these. Why do they do this? Is a coach required by the league to talk to the press?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Each coach, yes.
There you go.
Well, that explains it then.
But because there's so many people that cover Parcells' press conference, they gather in a big room and you have to wait for it to start.
Yeah.
It's on the air live.
Sure.
And Dave is down there. He can see when Bill's ready to speak. Mm-hmm. And they want to hit it right when he starts.
Oh.
So they kind of have to kill some time.
Literally.
Man, that's stressful, isn't it? Wow.
Good grief. Painful.
A lot of people.
Biggest idiot of the week goes to Coy Detmer, the quarterback of the Eagles. Eagles have the worst offense in the league, one of the worst teams in the league, playing in Green Bay at Lambeau Field. Guy actually throws a couple of touchdown passes. They lead 13-10. So what does he do? He turns and he taunts the Packer bench out on the field. Packers get annoyed, come back and beat the Philadelphia Eagles at Lambeau. Coy Detmer, his first NFL start, a memorable one for the youngster. College basketball, interesting game between Seton Hall.
How did they taunt them? What did they do? Some kind of,
shooting a gun like Barb does, that whole thing.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. College basketball between Seton Hall and Kane College. After 10 minutes, the score was Seton Hall 34, Kane nothing. Hall scores the first 34 points of a college basketball game. Hard to do. They finally won 108-46. And Randy Johnson will make his decision today. Free agent lefty will announce if he'll sign with the Dodgers, the Diamondbacks, the Angels, or the Rangers. There's also rumor that Johnson will retire and go into modeling. We'll find that later sometime today. And that's sports. I'm Mike Breen.
It is 9 minutes till the hour here on the I Miss the Morning program. And we're reduced now to having to watch the New York Giants and the San Francisco 49ers play football.
Man,
have you seen the pregame show, by the way, with that, who's the fat guy from ESPN?
Chris Berman.
Jesus, has Chris Berman in the past 10 years washed his hair?
What a slob.
God, he's just a hideous human being.
I don't think he has.
And with these hideous, horrible pet phrases of his call home runs.
He could go all the way!
Oh, God, it's so annoying. And there are a number of people who think it's maybe 10 who tell Chris how great that is. What an unattractive guy.
Yeah. Unattractive game.
And we have Chris Berman in one of these ESPN theme restaurants, right?
Mm-hmm.
Just full of people like Minko.
Yeah.
And Bob Asusen. What's the other guy's name?
Bob Wasusen.
Whatever his name is. Yeah, the guy who wanted. Just obnoxious sports morons. People like, the all that guy we kind of like. What's his name here?
Joe Buttabingo.
Yeah, we like him. But full of people like him. Drunk.
Yeah.
Screaming about. And then we have Frank Gifford with his. And so it's Frank Gifford.
With his essays.
And the dreadful Chris Berman with these pregame shows. Segued into Al Michaels, Boomer Esiason, and what's the fat guy's name?
Dan Dierdorf.
Who clearly all hate one another.
Yeah.
So
doing the Giants and the 49ers.
Yeah. Oh, but a football where it's pouring rain according to Boomer. So. And the Giants are just a dreadful football team. What happened to them?
Giants will win tonight. Not just cover the spread, they will win.
What is the spread? About 16 points?
Something like that. It's happened before, it'll happen again.
The Giants will win tonight.
That's correct. Niners a team on the decline.
Not here, Nanny. I'm his morning program. Blind man, super white boy, P. Feast Dupree.
Morning, boy.
How you doing, Feast?
Better fine. How you doing?
Got the blues on, son.
I sure enough do.
Got them nasty Lovick blues.
Want to hear?
Yeah.
Here we go. Well, that little fat girl, Monica, she's sitting in the driver's seat today. 'Cause she wasn't blowing no harmonica, and now she got herself a sample of Bubba's DNA. It's a smoking gun just like the one with OJ's Bruno Mali shoes. And so Bubba's feeling heart sick, 'cause he ain't got no clever rhetoric that can cure him of them nasty Lovick blues. With him I would not trade places, not for that Powerball's 290 million bucks. For the trouble he now faces, 'cause she once did, and now his situation really sucks. See, it behoove her to make like a Hoover with no stain remover for the ensuing ooze. And things is getting hectic, and Bubba's apoplectic. He'd rather be bitten by a deer tick than have them tricky, icky, love ick blues. The table's sure been toying, 'cause now I feel Bubba's pain. He played with fire and got boiling by a dried up semen stain. So when you feeling spunky, I hope you don't succumb to Bubba's fate. Just go and spank your monkey, but be careful on what or who you might ejaculate.
Oh, come on.
Masturbation's the same sensation without damnation or being accused by some fat chick who is lovesick, 'cause she put some lipstick on your dipstick and left a telltale oil slick. Make you wanna take some arsenic, 'cause you got them tricky wicky, dribble dicky, so slick and sticky it make you sicky. Somebody please hand me a tissue, I got them Lovick blues. Damn, I made a mess.
I took one look and I was fractured. I tried to walk but I was lame. I tried to talk but I just stuttered. Why, what's your name?
What's your name?
What's your name?
What's your name?
I'm here with PC Modem,
the confidence that compelled the station to subscribe to the Imus in the Morning program in the first place. The entertainment and revenue-generating portion of the broadcast day, the Imus in the Morning program, will resume tomorrow morning. Check your local listings for time and schedule.
WFAN New York. WFAN 2020 Sports.
Good morning, 10 o'clock. This is John Minko. Jet quarterback Vinny Testaverde says the club controls its own destiny. There's a two-way tie for the top spot in the AFC East this morning. The Jets and Dolphins sporting records of 8-4.
Yeah, you never talk about car races. Right here now with comment and observation on headline issues of the day, Imus in Washington, senior political analyst, the late Richard M. Nixon.
Yes, yes.
Very well. Very well. I miss the morning. Thank you very much for affording me this opportunity to join you live here, which, of course, is no small feat, as you know, since I'm dead. So, Raleigh, North Carolina, right? Let me see if I can put your audience at ease a bit by demonstrating that I am in tune with some of the things that they hold reverent. How about... Well, car's running real strong, real strong. We up a lap on old Dale there and running real strong. Jesus, what a bunch of goobers. You suppose between everybody in this whole room, there's one full set of teeth? Now, you know what PhD stands for down here, don't you, Donald?
No.
Pigs, hogs, and duh. But regardless of that, it is instructive, in my view, to venture out into these more genuine areas of our great land, far beyond the Beltway, to assess the mood of the electorate concerning the dark journey on which we're embarked. You know, a president of the United States facing the very real possibility of being impeached.
That's the word.
I know the word, impeached. Yes, for Christ's sakes, impeached. Fine. You don't have to just dwell on it. Anywho, J.D., I'm sure you'd agree. It is a treacherous, ugly time in our country. A very difficult...
Well, yeah, I think finding everybody's bedrooms is a
hideous way. Jesus, God, put a sock on it, will you? Well, nobody cares what you think. I was making a rhetorical point, you butt munch. Anyway, Dono, in my judgment, Democrats offended or no, Hard to see how President Clinton can avoid a Republican-controlled House, voting in favor of articles of, you know, impeachment.
Yeah.
Consequence, I see us launched into a great national discourse on such fundamental matters as the separation of powers and the definition of basic human behavioral issues. What, indeed, is sex? How does one properly define that most mysterious realm of our psyche? And I heard the noted columnist Frank Rich on your very fine program the other day musing about things that would have to be addressed as impeachment hearings unfolded. I was particularly struck by one matter Mr. Rich raised, and I'd like to explore it further, Barry.
Sure.
That is the potential for some regrettable public display should Henry Hyde and Barney Frank engage in a debate over the nature of oral sex. Now, let's just think here. What can Barney Frank bring to a discussion of oral sex, do you suppose? No, by golly, at second glance, let's not think what Barney Frank might bring to that discussion of oral sex. We just get bogged down, doubtless, in a more legalese regarding whether one's, when one's goober is gobbled. Is the gobbler of said goober engaged in sex alone? Or is the owner of the goober being gobbled also engaged in sex by mere fact of being the object of the gobbler's attention? Who is gobbler and who is gobblee? And is gobbling a goober in and of itself prima facie evidence of mutual sex in that gobblee had to grant, confer, or imply permission to gobbler to be gobbled, or goober gobbling would never have occurred in the first place? You see what a you-know-what mess our fine friend from Arkansas has gotten us into.
Yeah,
I mean, Jesus, Dotto, all I ever did was run some damn Cubans into Larry O'Brien's office, and for that I got my ass handed to me. Well, my time's exhausted, Dotto, and so am I. So if you'll indulge me in a moment, here's just a touch of a celebrated old song of the South I used to play on the piano that all these Carolinians will recognize, revamped a bit to reflect the new morality at the Clinton White House. Oh, nothing could be finer than to be inside a miner in the morning. There you have it, I do. A crude look at some sexually graphic testimony in the Big Scope today by Dick Nixon, former president of the United States, who takes his leave now with that hallowed old Raleigh-Durham rebel yell, tobacco forever.
Dick Nixon here on the Army Command Program. It is 31 after the hour. You're now the Washington Bureau Chief for NBC News. The host of Meet the Press, Tim Russert. Good morning, Mr. Russert.
Good morning. Is this morning?
No.
It is? Are you sure?
Yeah.
It depends what you mean by is. And it depends what you mean by good. You know, Don, when I'm on the phone with you, it's never like we're really alone.
No.
By the way, Don, when you bend over in front of the camera,
yeah,
don't do that.
Why?
With your head?
Yeah.
You have an Al Gore spot.
No, I don't.
Yes, you do.
No, I don't. Oh,
bend over.
I absolutely
right now.
Oh, no.
Take
it. No,
look.
Right
there.
No, I don't.
Stay right there.
I do not.
If your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the morning.
I want to clear this hair thing up. I mean, I've got great hair. I mean, I have no... This is so upsetting to me, and I don't know why you do this to me.
You know, Don,
push my buttons all the time, and I every time you say something, I don't, Charles. You really got my number because I just blow up and overreact, and now I'll be agonizing about this for weeks.
You know what I love, though? The other day you said that Keith Olbermann was self-absorbed.
Well, yeah. Yeah.
In the morning.
Traveling with us down here from the Archdiocese there in New York City, please welcome to the Imus in the Morning program our friend, John Cardinal O'Connor. Good morning, Cardinal O'Connor.
Good morning, God bless. Did you say this, Mr. Barnes?
Yeah.
Serious note, Mr. Barnes.
Sure.
This nation recently had to suffer through headlines and stories in the news, which, quite frankly, have been excessive and difficult to sit through.
Yeah.
And how did it all start, hey, Mr. Marr?
No.
Like it always does. A little blowing.
Yeah.
A little blowing here, a little blowing there. Next thing you know, it's a full-fledged hurricane, hey, Mr. Marr. Subject to the coverage of homeless Cubans, the Puerto Ricans and Dominicans, bejeez, whining about no electricity or plumbing, and as if they ever had any, bejeez. Nobody cares. No Sammy Sosa fans in this crowd, I'll tell you that, hey, Mr. Marr. Maybe now Fidel Castro can wash that filthy beard of his. She reminds me, Mr. Marr.
Yeah.
Saw a picture of Fidel Castro with a cigar hanging from his lips.
Yeah.
For a moment, I thought it was a piece of evidence from the Ken Starr report. Jeez, you know what I mean? Make you sick. Clinton and Lewinsky said there was no intercourse, though there was some genital-to-genital contact.
Yeah.
Thank God. Talk about beating around the bush, eh, Mr. Marvin?
I'll have it, baby.
Winning numbers in the New York State Lottery is as follows.
Good, let's have the numbers.
Before we do that, eh, Mr. Marvin, do us one favor.
Sure.
You explain to us the overwhelming support of Bill Clinton by colored people, by the blacks. Go on ahead.
You have the floor, eh, Mr. Marvin. Speak ahead.
Well,
go on ahead, Mr. MSNBC. Stop flapping those skinny lips. We're listening. Let's hear it. I don't have an ear.
You useless old windbag, you Jesus. The damn bell curve thing or some damn thing. The nation's blacks have become just one big OJ jury, eh, Mr. Marvin? Thanks for your insight, you wrinkled up old cokehead, you be Jesus. The Daily Number.
Well, God, let's have one number, some number, any number.
Speaking of my brothers, eh, Mr. Marvin?
Yeah.
Reading the story in the local newspaper by black columnist Barry Saunders.
Yes.
Very impressed by the use of the, by his use of the English language, eh, Mr. Marvin?
Let's not go too far here.
Folks in North Carolina respect his intelligence.
Yes.
Understand people in his own newsroom refer to him as William F. Buckwheat, be Jesus.
No.
I praise indeed. I'd like to meet the man.
Not William F. Buckwheat. That's not where we want to go.
Well, I'm Mr. Marvin. South Carolina has Strom Thurmond. Now today, North Carolina has the I-Man. Two horny old goats who just won't get out, be Jesus. By the way, congratulations on getting your picture on that new $20 bill, eh, Mr. Marvin? You're really looking forward to that. How's the I-Dad making out on the road, eh, Mr. Marvin?
I'm doing fine.
Missing the sound of the cute wee fella goo-gooing around the house, eh, Mr. Marvin, are you? Let me ask you this. What are you going to do when the boy's 16 and he asks to use the car?
Well?
Throw him the keys to the ambulance or some damn thing, Jesus. The incontinent imbecile, you. Good luck golfing on Monday, eh, Mr. Marvin?
Thank you.
Myself and the staff will say a prayer. That the I-Man has at least one good stroke, be Jesus. Anytime soon, you wrinkle up old wimp, you. The pick 10 numbers is as follows.
Got any number, please.
Funny to hear, eh, Mr. Marvin? Funny to hear Hillary Clinton up in New York complaining that Senator D'Amato keeps women down, be Jesus.
Huh?
Of all the gall. Perhaps he should make them just go down at the workplace, be Jesus. Everything would be just ducky.
That would be fine.
Maybe if Hillary made better use of her lips, buck tooth teeth, and flapping gums, we wouldn't be in the mess we're in now, be Jesus. Throw them out.
I just don't think we need to go there.
Which doesn't belong and why?
It's my favorite part because it's the end.
Which doesn't belong and why?
Which doesn't belong and why?
A, singer Kurt Cobain.
Singer Kurt Cobain.
B, writer Ernest Hemingway.
Writer Ernest Hemingway.
C, talker Don Imus. Which doesn't belong and why?
Well, I would say me, Imus.
Right, you pigeon-chested prick, you be Jesus. God forgive me. While all three of these tortured entertainers found solace in drugs and booze,
yeah,
and have been featured on A&E's biography,
yeah,
the answer is C, Mr. Marvin, as you said. The I-Man doesn't belong because, unlike the other two, the I-Man only looks like he took a shotgun blast to the face, be Jesus. On ahead, you schmuck, you.
John Colonel O'Connor.
Move along.
It is 17 minutes till the hour.
We declare our right on this earth.
10:20, 24. Spend your time listening to Imus in the Morning and sports all day here on The Fan, Sports Radio 66, WFAN, New York.
I'm here with PC
Boys.
I noticed you got a feet right on the front of your hat there, Feet.
I like that, right?
I do, yeah.
That's my logo. That's like a turquoise buffalo. That's my foot logo.
You know, here's the thing I'm wondering. If you are blind,
yes, sir,
why are you looking at me?
I just time where the noise is coming out.
Oh, okay. Well, that makes sense. What you going to sing for us this morning?
I got the Raleigh Blues, boy.
The Raleigh Blues?
Yes, sir, okay. I do.
All right, let's
want to hear?
Yes, I got it.
Go something like this here.
Well, we're sitting here in Raleigh, prettiest little city across the Mason-Dixon line. Feeling melancholy, cause we're sick to death of hearing our man whine. But not as sick as the our man is of the story of Bubba and his little in-time concubine. It was a sort of situation, the fat girl and the fat pantload from Hope. Some late night Oval Office dictation, getting off on some hot and heavy touchy-feely rope-a-dope. And when Bubba gets off with just probation, that's when the Iron Man really gonna start to mope. They eat barbecue here in Raleigh, and it be bad to the bone. Monica ate Bubba Q, by golly, while he was talking on the phone. But now that he's shown a little contrition, everybody wanna just move on when push come to shove.
Bubba can't continue on his mission, and he should be thanking his lucky stars above. Saved by a legal definition, I guess it's true what they say, there really is more to love. Which, by the way, tickets are still available at the Eugene O'Neill Theater. 212-239-5200.
Why Mississippi White Boy Pig Feast for Free? Well, we are live here in Raleigh. Now, any of you folks here in Raleigh going to be in up there in New York and don't have anything to do,
a little arrangement that we have with Blind, is that it, between the Eye Man and Blind?
Rob Bartlett, and the starring in his very own Broadway comedy, More to Love, a big fat comedy, appropriately.
Would you own a big fat piece?
No, I don't.
You have invested thousands. You never will say that. You've got to divulge that. You have invested thousands of dollars, and probably wisely, but you have to divulge that information.
No, not probably wisely. Right? Didn't you do the same thing, Larry?
Yeah.
Didn't you?
And
I lied, too.
And you did.
You did put your money where your mouth is.
But I put...
Good point. I put my money where my mouth is. I must think there's something...
Why don't you put your mouth where my money is? Ooh, that's cold. Why don't you put your mouth where my penis is?
I've got a never-ending love for you. From now on, that's all I want to do. From the first time we met, I knew I'd have a never-ending love for you.
I'm a in the morning.
Last time tapped to America, they were...
There's nothing else going on the program, so...
Jets are 8-4, handed the Carolina Panthers their heads 48-21. The game, as always, captured well on the New York Jets Radio Network postgame show with reporter Dave Jennings
and the Bill Parcells press conference.
And Bill Parcells is up on the podium. It's going to be a few seconds, though, before he's able to start because there are a lot of people outside filing in. So we'll just have to wait for these folks to bear in.
This is great radio.
Two nice wins in a row, 8-4.
Still in first place.
Four to go. And I'm just here, Frank Ramos. A lot of people outside. Chiefs beat the Cardinals 31-24. We just had the final score.
I'm not great.
How's your mom?
A lot of people outside. Takes a while for them to file in here. This room is just off the locker room.
Need to get some gas on the way home.
And Bill's standing up on the podium waiting for us.
If your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the Morning.
Guys, there's room up front.
A lot of people outside. There's not much more I can tell you, folks.
That's about it.
A lot of people outside.
Why do they throw it to him? Why don't they wait till they're ready?
Exactly.
I saw cats over the weekend.
In the morning.
True holiday spirit, Fujifilm offering great deals on its film and quick snap products. Get a buck off on the purchase of any Fujifilm 24 exposures or more. Headline issues of the day. I'm Mr. Washington's senior political analyst, the late Richard M. Nixon.
Yes, indeed. And thank you very much, as always, Imus in the Morning, for permitting me another opportunity to share with you the benefit of my extraordinary political experience. Now, as you know, I'm able to bring a particularly acute appraisal to the current matter unfolding on Capitol Hill. And after long and careful review, comparing the current president's situation to my own, I have concluded this. Perhaps it didn't occur in the physical sense, but somebody's getting...
No.
Oops, sorry. Did you beep that? I mean, hosed. Somebody's getting hosed. In my view, President Clinton is, in fact, a victim, guilty of doing nothing more than I myself did back there in 72, 73, when the forces of evil started aligning against me. And that is to act out the part of the alpha male, as do you and so many of us born to leadership. We are dominant, I dude, and we can't help it.
No.
I sought to ensure power.
No.
You scream at underlings. And Bubber, well, he did both, in my view, exhibited dominance by grabbing the ears of an underling and poking his phallus in her bridge work, while we can assume screaming go, baby. Very explainable, very natural. A simple behavior of leadership and supremacy, which the American people have said they understand, whether that net-noggin Ken Starr does or not. I am in agreement with you, J.D. End it. Let's all go home and get a little. Case closed. Now then, issue two today extends to one of those covering these matters, Dono, the big baby on the big show, or Keith Olbermann's analysis paralysis. Jesus, I hesitate to say anything that might further aggravate the work-related psychosis that has put Keith in therapy. However, that said, here's my counsel regarding the angst Keith is suffering as a result of having to lower himself to cover the Lewinsky story. The angst that he's deemed it necessary to share with all of us. Angst imperiling his career and propelling him into analysis after MSNBC threw him into the cruel contradiction, J.D., of reporting the message but hating the message. Keith, at this very fragile moment in your life, my advice is direct and quite simple. Kill yourself. And if you don't mind, since you're on TV, share that with us too. Jesus, what a sob sister. Issue 3, Dotto, as time runs short, the National Book Awards, or Fussy Predatory Pretension on Parade. To the chairman of the awards, Thomas Mallon, who gushed that the winning novel had a voice like nothing we could recall, that it found us and was what we kept hearing. And to playwright Wendy Wasserstein, who effervesced that the ceremony was a celebration of the author's craft and the continuity of the American voice. And to the gaudy denizens of bookdom gathered there to slap one another's waspy bony back, I add this. May all of your voices soon fall mercifully silent, aphonically zipped by blessed, incurable laryngitis, induced by the primal thrustings of the leader of the free world's pecker.
No.
I've got your charming Billy. Ouch! And there, appropriately, is the view through the Dickscope today, I dude, by a previous president, now deceased, of the very same United States.
Please help me, I'm falling in love with you. Close the door to temptation.
Thinking about selling
Washington, D.C., Vernon Jordan. Good morning, Mr. Jordan.
Excuse me if my voice appear a little strained this morning, but I have been rigorously and continuously screaming at my television lately because I am sicker than a Hebrew bulimic at a pig picking, a Tim Russett, John McLaughlin, and every other Sunday TV fat white boy incessantly ruminating over the Monica Lewinsky story. We got the message. End time done blown the president, blown the whistle, and the whole damn thing blown out of proportion. Move on. Bubba got stung, the fat lady sung, move on. But meet the press, face the nation, confront the country, whatever the hell you call them tedious little political pundit ego fests, all insist on squeezing the last little bits of prurience out of this story like Jesse Jackson sucking the marrow out of neck bone. Sweeps period is over, boys, and nobody cares if and he tried to snow job about the job, so long as they got a job. Move on. They spent more time talking about them 81 questions than the president did answering them, whining about the inconsistencies of the two testimonies. Well, Bubba didn't commit no perjury or obstruction of justice. He just a little fuzzy on the details, see? Do you remember every time you got buck wild with some bezo, ended up with some Jerry Curl on your Jimmy Jammy? No. It's real easy to forget a face when it been sitting on yours. And nobody get more stinky on his hang down than Bubba. So how he gonna recall every little sort of detail? Ain't no average healthy American man can account for every sexual encounter he ever had. Except maybe Ken Starr, because what ones he didn't have by way of his one hand, he can count on the fingers of the other. You know this monkey ass only knocking boots about 3-4 times annually, including his birthday, Father's Day, and New Year's Eve. The independent counselor, like the high school mathlete with the pocket protector and the kick me sign on his back, who living vicariously through the exploits of the BMOC quarterback. So I understand why he didn't want to let go of this story. But for the life of me, Amos, I can't understand why Russett and all his cronies want to perpetuate it. The only thing I can figure is, just like Kenny Starr is obsessed with the president, these media morons is all infatuated with the I-Man. Ain't a one among them who wouldn't trade places with you, Amos. And I guess so long as they're reporting on the Lewinsky situation, they can pretend they just like you. Go on the air and say the word penis 50 times an hour. You got to remember that this all started when Bubba showed his piggly wiggly to Paula Jones. So for all y'all peckerheads what got presidential penis envy, don't forget this. It's one thing to see one, it's a whole nother thing to be one.
Have mercy. All right, here now in the Imus of the Morning program, Chubba Bubba would tell me something.
I get knocked down, but I get up again. You're never gonna keep me down. I get knocked down, but I get up again. You're never gonna keep me down. I get knocked down, but I get up again. You're never gonna keep me down. I get knocked down, but I get up again. You're never gonna keep me down. The Mike Gatsby deal, this is Narrow Steel, the Dick Morris deal, the debacle over national health care, in a hotel with Paula in my underwear.
Oh, Billy boy, Billy boy, Billy boy.
I get knocked down, but I get up again. You're never gonna keep me down. I get knocked down, but I get up again. You're never gonna keep me down. I get knocked down, but I get up again. You're never gonna keep me down. I get knocked down, but I get up again. You're never gonna keep me down.
How will they remember me? What is my legacy?
The crooked land deal, the crooked penis deal, the Charlie Tree deal, the Johnny Wag deal, missing bill of records found in the book room, booking overnights in the Lincoln bedroom.
Don't cry for me, Janet Reno.
Independent counsel.
Ah! I get
the not in hell deal, the Tuba Tuba deal, the saxophone deal, a legal loan deal, building a bridge to the 21st century, testifying and committing the perjury, the Vince Foster deal, the Mike Espy deal, the Sid Narrows deal, the Dick Morris deal, the debacle over national health care, in a hotel falling in my underwear, the crooked land deal, the crooked penis deal, the Charlie Tree deal, the Johnny Wang deal, missing bill and records found in the book room, booking overnights in the Lincoln bedroom, the not in hell deal, the Tuba Tuba deal, the saxophone deal, the legal loan deal, building a bridge to the 21st century, testifying and committing the perjury.
It's a cheating situation, a stealing invitation, to take what's not really ours, to make it through the midnight hour. It's a cheating situation, just a cheap imitation, doing what we have to do when there's no love at home.
I'm a in the morning.
Old Mo Bandy. Here on your heartbreak radio station, people. Atlanta was gracious enough to cough up some cash and that fat hair lip there at CNN. Good morning, Hollywood.
Congratulations, brother, going on KRLA this morning. There's room for you out here in California, brother, now that Gene Autry's dead. I'll tell you something else, brother. The world's going to need another Pansy Poindexter prosecutor pretty soon. I'm going after the Independent Council. I'm telling you right now, Ken Starr's ass is grass, and I'm a Mexican landscaper, brother.
What?
I'm a Mexican landscaper.
Okay.
He bought a six-pack of whoop-ass, and there's no deposit, no return, brother, because I'm sick of all the time and money he's wasted trying to take down this president. Bubba answered the 81 questions. Nobody cares. Move on. We don't need no Stradamus to tell us the fat girl hungered down in his trouser weasel. I'm
what? He did what now?
Right now to a steel cage death match.
Hollywood?
What?
Go back a couple lines. I missed that.
We don't need no Stradamus to tell us the fat girl hunkered down in Clinton's trouser weasel.
Okay, that's better.
So I'm challenging Star right now to a steel cage death match. Me and him, mano a mano. Hollywood versus the Hollow Woody. That turkey's getting his rectal temperature taken with a meat thermometer. brother. I'm an iron-pumping, roid-rage, cliche, brother. I was once top of the heap, and now I got to resort to calling you on the telephone for validity. The movie career went down quicker than the White House intern, brother, and now I'm back as a performing seal for Rick Butler's grandfather and his commie trophy wife. I beseech you, brother, kill me now. Put an end to the hellish torture that's my miserable life. Stop the world. Hollywood's getting off. He's lost the will to live. I'm putting an end to it all, brother. I'm checking out of the Hotel California. But when I do, I'm going out a blaze of glory and I'm taking Ten Star with me.
I want you to listen to me. I'm going to say this again. I did not have sexual relations with that woman, Miss Lewinsky. I never told anybody to lie, not a single time, never. These allegations are false, and I need to go back to work for the American people.
Tell your mama, tell your pa, gonna see him right now. I'm just so mama, she don't do right.
Offering a 7-year deal worth $88 million, and the Red Sox considering an option for an 8th year. Meanwhile, the Yankees continue to talk with Albert Bell, the outfielder whose outrageous reputation off the field is matched by his prowess at the plate, is in line for a 4-year deal worth $12 million a season. And the Yanks sailed a Cablevision apparently off the sticking point over the deal, the amount of control George Steinbrenner would retain. The NBA and the new year, that is next. Fan 2020 Sports, sponsored by Coastal's Running Clean Gasoline. Coastal, the brand of a Maverick.
You can feel it before you see it. The feeling of unbridled power and freedom. Imagine boldly riding bareback amongst a herd of untamed mavericks. You're feeling the power of 93 octane Coastal Running Clean Gasoline. Coastal 93 octane Running Clean Gasolines are precision formulated for higher performance engines that need it, delivering the necessary octane for optimum engine performance for serious drivers who demand it. Packed with patented detergent additives to help keep engines clean and lean. But it's not for everyone. Only those whose cars demand premium octane. Unleash the power of running clean 93 octane gasoline. Pure horsepower for all the horses under your hood. Only at Coastal. The brand of a Maverick.
WFAN 2020 Sports Time is 10:03.
For me, it's excitement. And I just need to do it to stay in shape and just be around the players and just, you know, be united with them.
That is Phoenix forward Antonio McDyess reinforcing the players' resolve in its bargaining with NBA owners. The two sides have postponed Saturday's negotiating session, and now the league has canceled the slate of games for Christmas Day, which had the Knicks taking on the Bulls and the Lakers going up against the Phoenix Suns. Now it looks like early 1999 as the target date, if any, for the start of the NBA season. College basketball last night included second-ranked Connecticut beating Hartford 95-58, and Syracuse advancing to the finals of the Maui Invitational with a 58-46 win over Michigan. The Orangemen will take on Indiana, who beat Utah 52-49. Just three games in the NHL last night. Boston beat Tampa Bay 4-1, St. Louis blanked Nashville 4-0, and Phoenix a 3-2 winner over Chicago. And WFAN reminding you that the 8th annual YMCA Sports Benefit Auction will be held on Tuesday, December 8th from 5 until 8:30 p.m. in Madison Square Garden. It features great sports memorabilia. Call 212-630-9625 for reservations. And fan weather for today, partly sunny, a high of 50, but then tonight becoming cloudy, rain after midnight, a low of 42, and on Thanksgiving, rain ending in the afternoon with a high of 55. The current Central Park temperature, 44 degrees under sunny skies. That's what's happening. I'm Joe Tolleson with 2020 Sports and WFAN, the flagship station for New York Jets football.
It's the WFAN Double Play Sports Celebrity of the Day. If you think you know who today's Double Play Celebrity of the Day is, then listen to the Mike and the Mad Dog Show today between 5 and 6 p.m. for your chance to win $660. We'll also give away another $660 tomorrow morning between 7 and 8 a.m. on the Imus in the Morning Show. You guess the sports celebrity of the day, and we'll make it a double play by giving you two chances to win the cash. And now, here's a clue for today's sports celebrity of the day.
Besides Mickey Mantle, he is the only player to hit 50 or more homers in a season who has played with just one team his entire career.
Listen today between 5 and 6 p.m. and again tomorrow between 7 and 8 a.m. with Imus in the Morning to win here on The Fan. Sports Radio 66, WFAN New York.
Everybody, Russ Salzburg with you here on this Wednesday morning, the 25th day of November, 1998. The number, as always, is 718-937-6666. And as always, seated to my right, my partner, Steve Summers. It is the Sweater and the Schmoozer.
You can call us Russ and Steve
on Sports Radio 66, WFAN, New York.
The Yankee Clipper turns 84 today in a Florida hospital, and we wish him well. He is very, very sick as we speak this morning.
It started baseball's famous streak that's got us all aglow. He's just a man and not a freak, Jolting Joe DiMaggio.
Joe DiMaggio, we want you and I.
He tied the mark at 44, July the 1st, you know. Since then, he's hit a good 12 more, Jolting Joe DiMaggio.
Joe DiMaggio, we want you and I.
From coast to coast, that's all you'll hear of Joe, the one-man show. He's glorified the horse-hide steer, Jolting Joe DiMaggio.
Joe DiMaggio, we want you and I.
And I'm sure everybody, you know, not just Yankee fans, but baseball fans, people who were, you know, remember that era and have been part, even though we weren't part of watching that era, we were part of the stories that came with it, you know, in the 50s and 60s. And we just, you know, you wish DiMaggio well, and he is the Yankee Clipper, and he is Joe D, and whatever's going to happen, let's just hope he's taken care of.
Yeah, well said. And if you can also say, too, Russ, that if Lou Gehrig is the pride of the Yankees, then certainly Joe DiMaggio, the class, if not the soul, of the Yankees and the franchise and a national icon, an American icon, a New York icon. And even though Morris Engelberg is a close personal friend, advisor, lawyer, has been denying over the last week and a half or so, about a heart attack or lung cancer. We certainly know that as we speak this morning, he turns 84 today, Joe DiMaggio. He is, of course, a very sick man, and of course, we wish him the best. The interesting thing is, and people ask, why is there such secrecy surrounding what is wrong with him, with the reports, whether they're local or whether they're national reports that Morris Engelberg is denying every other day? And I guess, Russ, it is the DiMaggio way, among other things, to remain very private. And I suppose, even though we are talking about how sick he is and people think about his passing, he obviously wants to protect that privacy, and in so many words is also saying, it's not